Okay, here's a question from someone who's watching the video on Facebook on how to build composite cusp by cusp. It says, how did you manage to make the instruments not stick to the composite? Okay, so you'll notice that I use two instruments to shape composite. In the video, which was done a few years ago, I was using some fancy instruments from Style Italiano. I rarely use that now. I use two instruments. I use a micro brush and I use a probe, a sickle probe. Any sickle probe, as long as it's not too fat. Micro brushes don't stick to composite resin. Now, if you buy the really cheap ones, the bristles will come out in the composite resin, and then you have fiber reinforced composite resin, or you have hairy composite resin, whichever you prefer. But micro brushes don't stick. You don't need to put bond on them. If you put bond on the micro brush while you're using it on composite, the bond lowers the filler content on the surface of your composite, and that makes it weaker. So micro brush, good quality, you don't need to put anything on them, they just don't stick. The probe that I use just doesn't stick either. So maybe it's the type of composite resin I'm using. I'm currently using GC Genial, although I may change that shortly. It doesn't stick to the probe. Now, I use heated composite, does it make a difference? I mean, if I use Z100, maybe it would stick, but it's also the way you use it. So I don't put it on the surface of the instrument and then move it all around. If you look very carefully, I'm tapping, tap, 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 like this. And when you tap, it doesn't tend to stick. If I want to get rid of excess, you'll notice I put the instrument on and I scrape it against the edge, and then the instrument sticks to the composite and that bit of composite comes off with the instrument. But it's the way you use it. So if you tap it, you know, tap, 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 it doesn't tend to. If you just sit there and press it into the composite and then try and move it, then it will stick. But mostly, I just don't have a problem with things sticking. So tap the instrument against the composite. Don't sit there and hold it against the composite and then it won't stick. It says, are you working without etching? No, I'm not working without etching, so I always etch the enamel. If it's not in the video, it's because I left out that step because it wasn't important to showing you how to shape. One of the key parts to not having stain on any composite resin is etching the enamel well. You need to have the enamel clean. It needs to be part plaque free, stain free, calculus free, everything free, silver oxide free. There can be nothing on the enamel, so it needs to be aerobrated first. Then it needs to be etched, and then you can use whatever. So I'm using a self-etching bonding agent, SE Bond 2 from Carrare. But if you use that without etching the enamel, you'll get brown margins. If you etch the enamel, you don't get brown margins. Now, I'd say is, couldn't you make an inlay adapt easier? You can make lots of things easy. I mean, you can extract the tooth, that's easier. Just because something's easy doesn't mean it's good. So I'm showing you how to do a composite resin. I'm not showing you how to do an inlay. An inlay is a different thing. Small inlays are a pain in the bum. If you do an inlay and it's easy, then if you do an inlay and it's easy, then it's a tooth that probably needs an inlay. If you're really struggling to fit the inlay, then it was probably too small and only needed a filling. So you can kind of tell whether you should do a filling or really an onlay. I rarely do inlays. I think if you're going to do indirect restorations, it should be if you're capping a cusp. If you're capping cusps, an onlay is indicated. If you're not capping cusps, it's probably not. Someone wrote here, can flowable composite or heated composite be used to cement a restoration? Yes, you can use heated composite. Heated composite is very popular in Europe, more than anywhere else, particularly Z100. You have to be careful about what type of composite you use. You can't just use every composite because some of them are so stiff that you can't seat the restoration. So you'll notice that a lot of the old studies were done with Z100. Z100 is much softer and much more runny than the modern paste composites. So actually, sometimes I think it's better. Anyway, because you can use a single shade and it looks terrific. But anyway, the Z100 is quite flowable for a paste composite. Once you heat it, it's very flowable. If you're going to heat it, you need to heat the composite. You need to heat the inlay or the onlay or the crown, so that everything stays hot for as long as possible, because as soon as you get on the tooth, it starts cooling down. Now, the problem with heated composite, in my experience, is that it's very hard to seat. So the advantage of heated composite, it's easier to clean up. So as you squeeze it down, it flows out and you can clean it off. And so once you finally get it down, there's almost no cleanup to be done. The flip side of that is it's very hard to get it down. So you push down, some excess comes out, you clean that up. You push down, more excess comes out. You push down and more excess comes out. And you push down and more excess, and you keep pushing and pushing and pushing. And when if you're using really fine veneers, then you're very hesitant to push because you're worried that you'll break them. So it's also very stressful at times pressing things down, hoping that you don't break stuff and hoping that you've actually seated it fully. So I tried it for a while, and in my experience, it was more difficult to use heated composite. The cleanup was easier, but the seating took so much longer, and I think that it's quicker. Overall, for me, it's quicker to use a resin luting cement, like whatever, Calibra, one from Ivoclar, whichever one. Yes, you can use flowable. Flowable tends to be a little bit too runny. So the advantage of the luting cements is the viscosity is quite nice for allowing you to seat stuff without resistance. And usually they have a gel phase where you can just set them a little bit and then clean everything out, and then you can set them fully. So your flowables, which I have used at times, sometimes I use flowable because I want to use a color modifier. So I'll use, you know, maybe an A3 or an A4 or A1, sometimes even an opaque white flowable to modify the color. Flowable tends to be a little bit too runny, so you have to hold things very carefully because otherwise it moves too easily, and it goes hard super quickly. So if you have excess and you hit it with the light, then it can be hard to clean up. But a resin luting cement is just a flowable, clear flowable, usually a clear or a coloured flowable composite, and they've just modified the light setting. So yes, you could use any of those things. Having everything meticulous matters more than what you actually use. Someone mentioned on one of our videos, what about applying glycerin to prevent oxygen inhibited layer? Does it have an effect on preventing pigmentation around the margins, or is the benefit only on the surface strength of the composite? I've done it both ways. I don't think it makes that much difference. The things that have made a big difference to pigmentation at the margins is, one, having the cavity prep smooth, okay? Having no unsupported enamel at the margins. Two, air abrading or having it perfectly clean, having it etched. And then generally, because of the way I finished my margins, I don't have to grind on them too much. So the more you grind on your margins, the more likely you are to get staining. But reality is, if you have the enamel clean, you have it well etched and it's supported, and you don't have unsupported crystals that can shear off, then you'll get good margins. Okay, if you don't have it cleaned, you don't have it etched, you don't have supported enamel rods, or if you bulk cure too much, then you'll get stained margins. So most staining of margins occurs buccal or lingual on the box, and that's because there's plaque there. Glycerin, I use if I'm putting a glaze layer, like if I'm putting a layer of unfilled resin over the top just to make it look pretty for photos, then I'll often put the glycerin on top and cure that, and that just makes it go so hard right to the surface. I suppose you could use something like OptiGlaze, which naturally goes hard to the surface and doesn't have an oxygen inhibited layer. Does it make a difference? I can't really tell you that. We can probably find 10 studies that says that it does, and 10 studies that says that it doesn't, which probably means it doesn't matter one way or the other. So just get in a routine that you like. Someone asks, how much time is required to extrude a tooth orthodontically so that you can bring the soft and hard tissues down? Usually you need about 3 months. Now, the tooth will come down quite quickly. So you can often bring a tooth down in between 2 and 4 weeks, but then you have to wait for the soft tissue and the bone to grow down with it. So it's that you're waiting for, not so much the tooth. So usually 3 months you can bring down the, if you're wanting to bring down the bone and the hard and soft tissues, then you need about 3 months. But it depends on how much you're trying to bring it down. Like sometimes you can actually extract the tooth orthodontically, so you just keep pulling it down, it just keeps bringing the soft and hard tissues down further and further. So it would depend on the case and how much tissue gain you're trying to get. Thank you very much. I hope you found that useful. Thank you.